acre of hemp makes 20 barrels of oil. No need for pesticides to poison all our soil. People got no food, they got no clothes, they got no rent.
Thank you for taking Time for Hemp. I'm your host, Casper Leitch. You are listening to Time for Hemp all around the world on iHeartRadio, Tumblr, SoundCloud, iTunes, Roku TV, any place where the internet makes a noise, so do we. And we got about 20 hosts on the network that are together making over 60 hours a week of original content about the need to end prohibition. Make it a point to stop by timeforhemp.com and check us out and make it a point to share us with your friends. It is Wednesday, and on Wednesday we put a spotlight on some of the hardworking people in America here on the big broadcast with my joint host, Judge Lenny Frieling. Good morning, Your Honor.
Good morning, Casper. Pleasure as always.
It is, and I know we've got a hardworking activist on the joint chat today. Don't forget, anytime you hear the word joint in the big broadcast, nearly 2.5 million people all around the world pack their pipes, their bongs, their vaporizers, and twist up a joint to take Time for Hemp. And as our joint guest today, we have Barry Gainsbourg. Good morning, Barry.
Hey, good morning. It's nice to make a joint appearance in front of you.
And it's nice to have you on our joint chat. I'm going to let my joint host join into this joint conversation while I smoke my joint and kick back and enjoy this joint chat on the big joint broadcast. Your Honor?
Casper, I have to say that I really find it fascinating that you can smoke and manage the show. I can't do that at the same time. I have to wait.
Well, we don't recommend that people utilize medicinal or recreational marijuana at work, but sometimes some of us are able to do so.
And some people function better when they're not, say, in pain or having a seizure.
And I'm told that I'm a lot nicer and more fun to be around when I'm medicated.
Nobody ever said I was nice.
Well, you're a judge. What do you expect?
Barry Gainsbourg. Rather
hey,
than
Judge Lenny.
A pleasure, Barry. Good to have you here. And Barry,
Thank you so much.
Absolutely. You bring a little different perspective as opposed to the big emphasis on philosophy, on approach. You're bringing us more the down-to-earth, day-to-day, ledger sheet, real thing. How do you make this work kind of an approach, which is just a fascinating change in our focus. There's so many places to start. It sounds like let me give you the opportunity to select where we start, and we'll go
well,
from there.
Well, sure. That's great. Well, listen, my advocacy on behalf of cannabis, the ending of prohibition started. I went to Johns Hopkins undergrad, and while I was there, we had a constitutional class, and I did my thesis paper on the misclassification of marijuana as a narcotic. This is back in the mid-1980s. So at a time prior to the Schedule I, they classified marijuana as a narcotic, which obviously by definition it could not be. And I never had a problem at that point. If you wanted to prohibit something, that's okay, but you had to classify it according to what it was. I can't call a car, you know, a gun and make those illegal because it certainly by definition isn't. Now, if you want to make a car illegal, you can, but you have to define it correctly. So I always thought there was a constitutional argument on that ground. But I tended to go to law school, and I stayed in the business world for a while. And then eventually, with the freeing up and the ganja rights becoming more popular in Jamaica, I got re-involved into the advocacy. And my background really was as an SEC attorney. So I did compliance work, I did work with regulatory agencies, did licensing, and other work that was really much more of a business nature as opposed to from a criminal point of view. of, you know, whether it was a felony or a misdemeanor or anything like that. So again, what I really like to try and do is take that business approach look, because at this point, it's not a question of whether it's legal. There are ways to do the business legally. It's a question of you complying with those rules and being protected to the best of your ability from prosecution on a federal level, as well as on a state level if you're doing it wrong.
Barry, let's jump just for a second, which is not really a jump. I hear what I believe to be two common myths from people in the business, from growers, and a lot of the other people in the business. What I'm hearing is the myth that hemp is legal in 50 states and that CBD, one of the cannabinoids, as we all know, is legal in 50 states. My current understanding is just not correct. Can you speak to that?
Yes. Thanks, Judge. You're absolutely right. That is a myth. People would like you to believe that to be the case, but there are many states where hemp is still illegal to grow. There are some that have programs in place where they can do research on hemp, where they can grow hemp through cooperatives on behalf of the state, but that doesn't allow for private use. Now, we all know there's a ton of uses for hemp, industrially speaking, in terms of textiles and cars and housing materials and other sustainable uses instead of plastic. But it's a myth that you can now go out there and create your own hemp business using hemp products. And as you spoke to, I believe the FDA has recently sent out a letter to eight major companies regarding claims being made if there are any medical benefits to CBDs, and claiming they are touting those, and that would have to get pharmaceutical approval and review by the FDA. So at this point, according to the FDA, CBDs are not legal to market for those uses either. So,
in Colorado, the definition we look at is the marijuana plant or any part of it or any salts, and there's a long list. And when they wrote that, they were really trying very hard to ban anything related to cannabis. It won World War II for us, arguably, and then they burned it all down as far as the hemp goes.
Yeah. But again, you have a lot of competing interests that are involved in this. So, you know.
One of the things that fascinates me on the legal end, I know you've talked about the Supremacy Clause, and I would like you to chat a bit because that's a little more legally technical than a lot of our listeners may be used to. So why don't we go right to that? What's the Supremacy Clause? Why am I even saying that?
Yeah. Now, this is because we live in a country of federalism. And I'm going to use two examples. I'll use the United States and I'll use Jamaica afterwards. So in the U.S., we have the federal government. You have federal courts, right? You have states, 50 states. You have state court systems. You also have local systems, towns. So on a federal level, if there is a federal law, it should preempt any state law. So if they made it illegal to have cars with five wheels, and that was a federal law, no state could allow it because the U.S., the federal government, has spoken to it. Now, the federal government has elected to schedule cannabis, and I use the word cannabis instead of marijuana because marijuana is really a slang term. It's a derogative term, so I use the Latin term of cannabis instead. So cannabis was scheduled, put down as a Schedule I drug, meaning it had no medical benefit and it was highly addictive. It's lumped in with heroin, I believe, and LSD. Now, obviously, we know that not to be the truth through the approval and medical proof and tests that had been done historically throughout the ages, but in Israel and Canada, Jamaica is doing testing as well. Now, the reason there isn't any testing in the U.S. is because of the Supremacy Clause. The Controlled Substance Act is a federal law. And because it is an illegal substance, any money that would derive of the sale, use, or processing of it would be deemed illegal proceeds. Again, you also cannot do legal research on an illegal substance. So again, the ability to conduct research in the U.S. had been severely curtailed based upon that classification. So that's where the Supremacy Clause is so important, because under the CSA, which is a federal law, according to the rest of the country, cannabis should be prohibited on any basis.
Let's jump without really jumping.
I'll skip with you.
Cool. we are hearing recently a lot about particular strains, for example, Tommy Chong's current effort to put out a particular strain. How does that fit in with a more normal business model where somebody might have a particular unique aspect to their product?
Well, it does, and it's very interesting because here you're speaking of intellectual property. Now, can I copyright a regular rose that grows or a regular grass? No. That's God-given. Now, if you start constructing strains that are your own, you get into intellectual property. So when you create a computer program, some software, when you create a book, when you create a process, what you're doing is that's your intellectual property. And just like anybody else who has the formula for Coca-Cola or who has a process in place for making ice or whatever it is, you have that intellectual property to protect. Now, part of the problem also is because of the Schedule I classification, federal copyright and trademark protection will not extend. And in fact, to anything that is cannabis related, I have tried to, on behalf of clients, get them to approve it, and certain language they will, and certain language they won't. Anything that goes to the use or to cannabis itself, they won't approve. They kick it back. Because again, to some extent, it's endorsing the use of, you know, an illegal substance, according to the federal government. However, there are some states where you can go to obtain that kind of protection, like in Colorado itself. So you get state intellectual property until that classification on a federal basis comes down, and you would be allowed to go for a federal trademark or copyright. So these are things you have to look at in planning your business. How are you going to protect what you're creating? Can anybody just come in and steal it from you?
One of the things that puzzles me that is related is this. Right now, as we know, there is in fact a patent on some medical uses, some antioxidant uses of marijuana cannabis that is being held by the United
government.
States. Yes.
You bet. And that completely undermines the Schedule I classification. How could you own something that doesn't exist? But the U.S. government says it does because it has these medical benefits, right, under the patent. And yet, on the other hand, they still continue to argue. It's a two-faced argument out of the other side of their mouth, right, that it has no medical benefit. It's a Schedule I drug.
It does amaze me that you can walk down a hallway in D.C. and go in the wrong door, and it's a Schedule I narcotic, and you go in the right door, and they've issued a patent, not by accident, but to the government. I believe the feds are holding it for the...
They sure are, and it was grown, I want to say, in Mississippi. It's one of the finest places to grow your stash.
They can grow anything there. Kentucky.
Yeah. That's the beauty of it. It grows anywhere. It grows outside. It creates a whole new economy, and it had always been there until Prohibition.
So there we're talking like 1904 to 1937, give or take?
Exactly. Exactly.
What about exactly. Before then? Did
you know,
the world
before
end?
Then, it was used as medicine. It was freely advertised. Cannabis, there was a tax if you wanted to use cannabis. There was, I think, a dollar tax on a pound. I forget what the amount is, but it was taxed as well. It was used medically. It was used across the globe. It was used in India and China and the Middle East, and they called it different things. But bottom line is, at some point, sativa and indica had always been used until the end of Prohibition, when the guy who was heading up the alcohol part of it had nothing really better to do. His name was Harry, I think it was Anschler. And he turned his... Yeah, Anslinger. And he turned his attention to saying that cannabis was used by minorities, that was the whole reefer madness stage where people were willing to believe that to be the truth because it was primarily used by minorities.
Are you trying to tell me that black people, people of color, do not smoke marijuana and rape white women?
I'm not trying to tell you they don't smoke weed and rape white women. Most of them don't, as opposed to what Donald Trump may believe, nor do the Mexicans candidly either. Yeah, No, people just smoking and they don't get off the couch. Or if they do, they go to 7-Eleven and they forget money and they have to barter with the guy up front for their burrito. That's about it.
To illustrate just how emotional the appeal was in the early 1900s, I think it's important that we keep in mind that the government program, prohibition, not only banned high THC type of cannabis, they banned rope.
Until we
needed it to win World War II, then they backed off on that a little
bit. Well, those were the large corporations that would paper the Hearst Company. They didn't want the competition, and the government was more than happy to assist them in that endeavor.
And that was the competition with hemp paper competing with Hearst's regular wood pulp.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Just like you had Pulp Fiction in all the books that were printed before. That's where the money was coming from.
So we've talked about strain protection a bit. Where do you see that going?
I see eventually, if you can prove that you've created stuff that is unique, that is not naturally occurring, and the rest of it, there will be. Just like, you know, I guess when it comes to medicine, it'll take a pharmaceutical model to it. But the basic strains or seeds that there have been, and this argument actually is going on in Jamaica as well, candidly. There are several who want strange protected under a Rastafarian intellectual property umbrella. And I think it's going to be a hard battle to win, candidly, you know, on that level. Now, there'll be other things that you can win on in terms of name rights or use or instrumentation or delivery method of the cannabis. That certainly, you know, is intellectual property and you can protect that. But I think it's really hard. Just like you can't copyright or protect a cross or a Star of David, or a crescent, you know? You just really can't protect things that are really public domain.
Could you trademark or otherwise protect, ignoring the narcotic problem, ignoring the Schedule I just for a moment, if I, for example, developed, and I'm begging growers to name one of their strains after the governor of New Jersey, I want to see Christy Chronic on the shelves.
Mm-hmm.
Would a name be protectable?
Ah, well, now the brand, right? Kellogg's
yes.
is protectable, sure. And if it was cornflakes or whatever it was, they could. They could do something like that. But what you couldn't do is protect the underlying seed or the genetics of it, unless that was special. But what you sell it under, right? It could be Christie's Crunchy, Chronic Christie's Crunchies, right? Whatever you want to call it. That you could protect.
I'd live to 67 to see that happen.
I bet you would.
Let's go back for a moment to the federal government.
You bet.
The feds are really running national banking. Is that a fair statement?
More than fair.
How does that fit into the picture?
Well, here's part of the problem. So now the states have said, you guys can build mansions in these states, and that's fine. All you have to do is you get the tools and you'll be fine. The federal government says that's fine, and your state may allow you now to build mansions in your state, but you can't have hammers or nails or any other tools, screwdrivers and the rest of it. Good luck to you, and we'll see how that goes. That's essentially what they're doing to show their disfavor towards a cannabis industry, because no national bank will extend credit or take on an account, because under the Schedule I, it is still considered the proceeds of crime, because cannabis is scheduled as a Schedule I substance. Now, no national bank will extend, but when that S1 classification comes down, you bet J.P. Morgan will be there with Chase Bank. You bet Bank of America will be there. You bet Citibank will be there, because there's money to be made. So the other approach has been to try and deal with state-chartered banks and credit unions, except the OCC and the Fed have stepped up when people have been loud about offering these services, these banking services, and they've been shut down even though they've started them. And again, a couple of things to keep in mind. I was in the securities industry in 2001 after 9-1-1, after 9-11. And one of the things you saw rapidly change was the taking of money into the financial system. So you all of a sudden had under the Patriot Act the introduction of anti-money laundering rules. And basically, you had to check where all sources of money were coming from, how it came into being, where they got their money. So that's all AML compliance. And they did it fairly quickly, within 2 years, and it was up and running. And nobody ever was rejected in terms of processes of having an account. Either you passed or failed, but nobody said, we don't have the ability to do this. They did it. And it really hasn't been an issue in the securities industry, because they have organizations called FinCEN that will send things around saying, we suspect criminal activity, respond to us by such and such date. So there are procedures and operations in place. Those same procedures can be used to check whether there's money laundering going on with cannabis. And in fact, cannabis is regulated in these states that many of them require seed-to-sale tracking. So if you can trace money, if you can trace the plant and the process from it being grown all the way to its sale, right, at the point of sale, you can do the exact opposite. You could trace the money coming in so it goes all the way back to when it was planted as a legally authorized seed. It's a real simple solution. And the government is misleading people, and the banks are misleading people, saying it's too complex. It isn't complex. They don't want it done, because I've seen it done on the terrorist side of it under the Patriot Act. It's a crock.
When it keeps passing through my mind that when civilians, when the government says, oh, we need more testing, I think about the search for the word marijuana on PubMed, P-U-B-M-E-D, filled with available studies, double-blind studies, peer-review studies. If you search for marijuana, you'll get 20,000 hits on PubMed, nowhere else. And I think of thalidomide, which our younger listeners may well not know. I wonder how much testing they did on thalidomide.
No, exactly. And there's enough anecdotal evidence and empirical evidence. Nobody's ever died of an overdose of smoking cannabis. Hasn't happened. That can't be said about cigarettes. That can't be said about alcohol. That can't be said about opioids, period. So how many more studies do you need? The only time this substance has been barred is due to federal prohibition over the last 100 years. For the rest of history, it hasn't been an issue. That would be like saying we need to do more studies to see if milk is healthy for people to drink.
With cannabis, we know that in China and very possibly India, we're looking back 5,000 years where with cannabis, marijuana, I tend to call it cannabis, marijuana, and pot, just based on the switches over the years in what we're supposed to call it. So I just switch. But if you
at least you don't call it reefer, though.
You know, personally, I guess I don't. Going back 5,000 years in China, we're talking about a substance that was in their 5,000-year-old equivalent of what we call the PDR, physician's desk reference, now.
Right. Exactly. And I'll tell you something else. Back in the days of Jesus and Jerusalem, the oils that they probably were anointing people with were derived of hemp oil.
Well, that cuts both ways.
Indeed it does.
Let's jump to Jamaica, which sounds like really a pretty nice place to jump to.
It is a wonderful place to jump to. And actually, go ahead.
Please go ahead. I was just going to ask, what's going on there? We keep seeing Jamaica recently.
Yes. Well, some interesting things in Jamaica. Last year, they had amended their Dangerous Drugs Act. So marijuana there is called ganja. So cannabis there is called ganja, and they amended it, and basically eventually they're going to have legal recreational. But at this point, initially they legalized scientific research. So you have the universities and some medical organizations getting permits to conduct research. And then today, actually, April 4th originally, they were supposed to release the rules and regulations for the medical use of ganja on the island. Now, everybody is under the misimpression that you can use it recreationally in Jamaica, and it's still against the law. It has been decriminalized, meaning there's a $5 U.S. penalty if they catch you smoking. So if you've got $20, you could go over to a police station steps, sit down, hand the guy the $20 and say, I'm going to smoke four of these. You just watch, okay? So it's not the end of the world. But basically, here's what's going on. In Jamaica, when you get your cannabis or your marijuana, it's on a stem, and it's picked off a tree. It doesn't come in the baggies like in the U.S. So they have a different system of working it. The other thing is, because it's legal in the country of Jamaica, there's no banking issue. So there's no federalism issue either here. So there is banking. There is protection of intellectual property. It is a recognized legal industry as long as your business, just like in the States, complies with the rules and regulations. So they're going to have seed-to-sale tracking there. And they've never done that before. And they're going to have quality insurance so they see if there are pesticides being used, toxins, et cetera, fungus. So it's going to get checked for quality. They're also going to be able to trace where it's sold to. And again, they're going to have tea houses. So again, in Colorado, I know there are issues about you can go there and get it in Colorado, but you can only go back to your apartment or your hotel room and smoke it by yourself. There's no social outlet for it. They are initially going to have tea houses, and you'll be allowed to sit and smoke. So much more like Amsterdam. It becomes a social activity as well. So there are some substantial differences. Recreationally now, it is not legal there yet. Again, it's decriminalized. And again, many of the men will come down from the hills with the, you know, cannabis and sell it, and the taxi drivers will too. But those aren't going to be the legitimate businesses that will be importing and exporting. Because eventually, who wants to smoke Marley Natural with cannabis grown in California or Washington? You want to smoke ganja grown in St. Anne's Parish where he grew up. That's all there is to it eventually. So all these things will come online. But again, those bigger companies who want to be left alone and want to do it legally and have a real business will comply with what the country is saying in terms of, you know, filing for registration and being licensed properly and maintaining a certain code of conduct in conducting their business.
I'd be rooting for Thai Stick to be on our shelves. We were seeing that during the Vietnam War. Soldiers were coming back, and one of the things that was coming back with them was Thai Stick.
Yep. It's going to be very dynamic down there as well, just like it is in the States. So, you know, they're going to implement the scheme, and they're going to see what works and doesn't work, and there are going to be changes. You know, that's how the industry is right now. It's trying to learn from each other and what has worked and what hasn't.
It seems to me that, as we know, Colorado has had a two-year residency, and they were pretty strict in the definition of residency in order to be an owner, an investor, basically the people in the top tier of the business. There's been a two-year residency requirement. Do you know that we have changed that somewhat just recently?
I am not aware. I know there are always discussions in certain states like Alaska and Hawaii have that. And actually, when I've been consulted with Jamaica, now you see the benefits and the detriments of it. The benefit is, in Jamaica, for example, you have the Rastafari, right? And they've been carrying this fight for such a long, long time. And what you've seen over the history of Jamaica is that the Europeans have come and exploited the land. They've taken the resources. Well, this is just the latest resource. So do you want to see the Europeans come in and exploit cannabis, which has been their gift? And the honest to God truth is, no, you don't, because you've seen how this has played out before. So there has to be a certain residency requirement, or at least ownership requirement, where you can have a foreigner maybe has 35% interest at a maximum, but the money and the business is kept on the island. So 65% with, you know, a Jamaican resident. And you could see how things like that preserve it in the home state or the home country. And something like that may work in the U.S. as well. So again, you're not disenfranchising people who want to invest money from other states. However, you're not letting ultimate control of these grassroots companies leave the state.
Well, I want to remind people that if they want to invest in Time for Hemp, that would be great. You can be an advertiser or a sponsor, or you can just hit the donate button on the homepage and help us raise the voice of the movement. We're going to take a commercial break and say thank you to our sponsors for being part of our family. And then we're going to listen to a song about how fantastic marijuana is. And then we're going to come back and pick up where we left off here at Time for Hemp.
listening to the Time for Hemp Global Broadcasting Network. Please share us with your friends.
THCF Medical Clinics are the premier physicians clinic in the United States. THCF has offices all across the United States from Hawaii to Michigan. THCF Medical Clinics has helped approximately 150,000 patients obtain their medical marijuana permits to legally possess, grow, and use medical marijuana. If you have chronic pain, multiple sclerosis, or any other neurological degenerative disease, or if you have any gastrointestinal disorders such as GERD, irritable bowel syndrome, or if you have AIDS, cancer, spastic disorders, seizure disorders, or glaucoma, call us at 1-800-723-0188 or visit us online at hemp.org. Again, the number is 1-800-723-0188 and the site is hemp.org.
This one.
Yes, I do like to inhale anytime I am around a vaporizer that's got good ganja in it or a bong or a good joint. Anytime that I can walk into a room and find secondhand smoke, I inhale. This is the Time for Hemp Radio Hour. You're listening to the Time for Hemp Global Broadcasting Network. We encourage you to get active and become part of the solution. Stop being part of the problem. Get up off that couch, get out the door, and let everybody know how important it is to end prohibition. With that said, I'm going to pass this joint chat back to my joint host and our joint guest here on the Big Joint Broadcast. Your Honor?
Thank you, Casper. Let's talk money for a minute, Barry. You're at the business end of this and have a much broader view of the way money works. Is the United States better off with our businesses and civilians getting hemp of varying qualities from Eastern Europe, Canada, and China, which is where it comes from now? Does that make any sense financially?
It doesn't make any sense on any level, candidly. You know, when you talk about bringing industry back to the United States, this is as simple as it comes. Because it's not that theirs is better than ours. We don't have it. So once we grow that and once we establish it, we'll do very well in those markets. Farming has always been an American industry since the very beginning. And at this point, unfortunately, most of it's being done on a corporate basis. But again, if you could get some farmers involved on a collective basis, you know, that would be a very interesting enterprise. Because again, hemp can be used for rope. Hemp can be used for textiles and clothing. Hemp can be used to produce cars. I've ridden in a car made of hemp. Ford tried to sell hemp cars and put them together. You can make housing out of hemp. Anything you can do with plastic, you can do with a hemp-derived substance. You know? So it's silly for us not to take advantage of that situation.
I understand that as a fiber to make fabrics, where you really want a much finer material than you would want for making rope, I understand that although that has been coming from Eastern Europe, that is now spreading and we'll be able to get more pleasant textiles, more softer fiber, softer fabrics.
Exactly, with the evolution of their processes. And again, American ingenuity can help on that front as well, as long as it has a chance to participate.
My position has been very simple. We're Americans. If we want to do it, we can do it. And if we elect to, we can do it better than anyone else. And we've done it consistently over hundreds of years.
Well, we share a joint opinion on that.
We, out here in Colorado, as you know, for years, we have forbidden any of the key players in any of the businesses, the owners, investors. We have forbidden out-of-state money from coming in to own part of a business. And just recently, that's changed a little bit. Does it make any sense that you can see for Colorado to be saying we don't want out-of-state money?
No, it doesn't make sense for anybody to say we don't want money when it's available. But there are certain rules and certain things you need to put into context. And as we were discussing before, again, you want to keep control in Colorado because you have the rules there. However, there are ways that they can kind of have the money made available to them through these instruments, and they're called options, which means you have a right but not an obligation to purchase at a certain price, and you will pay a premium up front for that. And they can take that money and use it towards the benefit of the company. There are ways also to do it, I guess, with bonds as well, which, you know, are essentially secured promissory notes. You know, so you can do a bond offering as well. What you can't do is do it through the equity portion. So, again, there are enough smart people to figure it out on a financial basis. But there's certainly money to be had. Now, until cannabis comes off of the S1 scheduling, you can't have a national listing. So it won't be on the New York Stock Exchange or NASDAQ or anything like that. Because once your fingers touch the cannabis, remember, it's the proceeds of criminal activity. It's prohibited. However, just like Levi Strauss did with the gold miners, if you sell enough pans, if you sell enough picks and enough dungarees and enough shirts and enough forks and enough food, you're really agnostic to who succeeds out of 10 people, right? You don't care. If three of them succeed and keep doing well, that's great, and they'll continue coming back. But you've sold to all 10 of them. So really, you don't have a bet on any particular player in the sector. You're just providing the know-how or procedures or advice or consulting to get them where they need to go. And then fate is on their side. And that's really where there's a ton of money to be made. So you don't actually need to have your fingers at all on the cannabis to participate in the industry or be funded in the industry, because those companies can be nationally listed.
I've spoken to a lot of people who sit down in the office and say, I want to be a cannapreneur. I want to start a cannabis business. And I think about 100% of the time, what I've said to them is, we had our first gold rush out here, and the people mining for the gold, panning for the gold, most of them ended up dirty or dead or both.
Or poor.
Or poor yeah. And dirty and dead. And then yeah. We have the people that were selling the picks and shovels, and they did just fine. And the ancillaries, the ancillaries we see out here include things like armored car companies, burglar alarms, video monitoring,
security,
construction, electricians, plumbers,
real estate.
Real estate in Colorado, you can't buy a warehouse here for love or money.
Right. Because there's demand, supply and demand.
There's supply and demand. And one of the things I see visually, this is not science. What I think I'm seeing are the people that used to buy their pot underground, which was the only way to buy it, are going
Correct.
To the store and choosing to buy it legally now.
Why not? There's no legal repercussion.
And the pricing is just fine. I know there are complaints, but not many that I buy into.
No, listen, if being given the opportunity to do it legally, where the product is supposed to be tested and there's a disclosed THC and you know what you're getting, right, and it's a clean place and, you know, there's no fear of arrest, you know, what could be wrong with that? That clears up, and it makes so many people who otherwise in the world would feel like a criminal for doing what they're doing when they're really not.
So people are being very creative. They're taking the bud, the shake, any part of the plant that they can get, but frequently trimmings and bud and shake.
Leaf and
and processing.
Make tea out of it. Yeah. You extract it. There are tons of things to do. You infuse the food. And that's honestly where one of the problems is with having a detectable, consistent amount of THC in the edibles. You could have a cookie, and most of the THC is on one side of it, so if we split it, you get nothing, and I'm flying high. And you're waiting for hours. And the other thing is, a lot of people who can smoke a lot of cannabis, they're not used to eating it or ingesting it. So they'll take something, they expect that instant high, like if you were smoking it or vaping it. And it doesn't happen that way. People can go from anywhere from 15 minutes to 2.5 hours. So when people don't get that instant effect, they go, oh, it's not working, I'm going to take another one. And that's where the problems arise. It's like taking someone who can drink 3 beers and they decide they're going to drink a bottle of vodka.
Well, that's an easier decision after you've had the 3 beers.
and a mess later, indeed.
And one of the problems we are having, because it's so difficult to find a legal place to smoke. I mean, look, let's face it. We've always found places to smoke that just didn't bother anyone. But if a tourist comes in and can't find a legal place to smoke, they're going to buy candy. And without the education, we get tourists eating 5 times, 10 times what would be a significant dose for somebody used to consuming THC.
Exactly. They're going from beer into hard alcohol. In fact, from beer to grain alcohol.
So beer to vodka, not both, huh?
No, you could do the vodka, but you're going right to grain alcohol when you go to the edibles like that. Again, it's not the same thing. it's not even the same high or the same feeling from the edible versus the smoke.
It is very different, which strikes me as kind of odd at the moment. I know that when we started seeing a lot of the concentrates here, some of the thick, goopy stuff that would move in the container, but you know, thick, goopy stuff. And 2 years ago, 3 years ago, if you vaped that, many of them had a distinctive, not healthy, volatile taste to them, almost like you were still tasting the butane. And I'm happy to report that that is not what I'm seeing these days.
So no, I much think, better.
I think our government can serve a purpose. I think regulation yes. can be a good thing.
Yes. And it should be. Listen, I want to know. Listen, I have kids that are in college, right? And basically, I would rather them smoke than drink, candidly. But if they're going to smoke, I would rather them know exactly what they're getting, what's in it, what it's been treated with. I don't want it coming from Vinny down the hall. I don't need that. Just like I wouldn't want him drinking alcohol that was made in somebody's shower at the dorm.
I'm thinking back to alcohol prohibition and how many people were crippled or killed by wood, by methanol instead of
right.
ethanol.
People didn't mix it right or get the right stuff.
They
or
poured
they
in
shortcuts.
What they poured in what they could get.
Yeah.
Reminds me of a James Cagney movie. Unfortunately, there was too much truth in it.
You dirty rat.
I can make better champagne than that in my bathtub.
Indeed.
As many did. Let's jump to a topic very briefly on the impact of our present list of presidential candidates. Very briefly. Who seems to be the most open to intelligent regulation?
Oh, I think this one would have to go to Bernie Sanders. His whole platform is basically cannabis should be legal federally. He has sponsored a bill in the U.S. Senate. That's a no question. And the only other one on the Republican side who really took a similar stance is Ron Paul because of his libertarian standings.
They sound more like
joint support.
They sound more like what I think of when I think of true Republican thinking. To me, the cannabis industry is such a true Republican issue. Everything from
and they don't embrace it. It is individual freedom.
Yes, states' rights.
I don't understand it. This is right in their breadbasket, and they won't take it.
Let's
and
talk
the Democrats
about-
are scared to take it too.
You're right, everyone's scared, and I think they're really not knowing what to do with the Florida 58%, and I call the 58% a victory. When it's tried
it was. You need 60 down here because it was a constitutional amendment, but nevertheless, we'll get it this year with the presidential election.
Well, that's good news.
It is. The only problem in Florida, though, is you have a Republican who is a teabag governor, and you have a Republican Senate and House who don't get along, and they've been trying to put in a Charlotte's Web bill, which has been authorized for 2 years, and they can't get the rules and regulations in place there. Nothing gives me greater hope that anything productive will be achieved, even if we vote that measure in this year either, candidly. They just don't want to implement it.
And when you say Charlotte's Web, you're referring to marijuana or cannabis that has a high amount of the CBD cannabinoid with a very low amount of the THC cannabinoid. And the THC, of course, is what gives you the high.
Right. And the CBD is supposed to treat certain conditions that a lot of children have, you know, and other people have as well, candidly. But again, they will not put procedures in place. And the other thing is they try to, again, this happened in Ohio also, where you see money overcoming the purpose and motivation of cannabis as well. They appointed one grower from each region, so there was a total of five, and you had to have 30 years of experience growing stuff. Doesn't mean 30 years experience growing cannabis, but if you grew watermelons or strawberries, which again is very different than growing cannabis. So it was a ridiculous process that has invited, as you would believe, a lot of litigation in the courts, which is currently pending.
One of
the
things
in the state of Florida.
Excellent. Good luck with it. One of the things that I find troubling, the Charlotte's Web, of course, with the high CBD amount, we think of when we think of the seizure baby issues. What troubles me is that there seems to be, if I'm reading this right, a trend for a state to say, all right, we're not going to doom a baby to 100 seizures an hour or 100 seizures a day. We're going to legalize only Charlotte's Web and other CBD strains. And now we are a medical marijuana state. So don't tell us that we're old-fashioned torturing babies. We're a medical marijuana state. I find that troubling.
Right. Yeah. No, that's exactly it. But it's not just in cannabis, but in human rights, in any movement to progress humanity, it always comes down to, you know, doing what's right because it's right. And getting that support. And then when you have the money that gets involved with it, and they no longer out of as well, you have a lot of people who put themselves out there saying they're caring and compassionate and they want to do these things. And again, really, it's all ego-driven, and a lot of people say a lot of things they can't back up, unfortunately. And they're charlatans in all industries. But obviously, as the cannabis industry is rising and evolving, we're seeing a lot of that at the ground level, I believe.
One of the things that we've seen in Colorado that upsets me terribly, we have a list of 9 magic conditions in our Constitution that are approved medical situations that you can medicate. We do not have post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD.
PTSD, yes, and it's beyond me why that's not included.
We have tried twice and failed, and look who we're torturing. A volunteer army.
Right. And everybody says, you know, we applaud the soldiers when they're at baseball games and we applaud their efforts for the. But if we really care about them, I tell you what, stop applauding them at baseball games. Stop applauding them at football games. Give them the resources from the VA that they so desperately need and the medical attention, and allow them to be treated for post-traumatic stress disorder. You are harming them more. What is it? The laws against marijuana have done more harm than marijuana itself. Yeah. The denial of their ability to get this does them more harm than the marijuana itself would on any level. It's just a ridiculous argument and a ridiculous position for our federal government to take.
I got to jump in here. One thing that's not ridiculous is the way that time flies. We are down to the last two minutes of this hour. So this gives us a chance to give a shout out to our favorite URLs and organizations. And we'll start with our joint guest.
Well, thank you. If you have any legal questions or you're interested in running a legally compliant cannabis business in your state or in Jamaica, please contact me. My name is Barry Gainsburg. My website is www.barry.gainsburg.com.
And your honor?
That was B-U-R-G Gainsburg, right?
It is with the U.
Barry, you're the future. You're the future here now.
And thank you, Judge. But it's pioneers like you that got us all to where we are today. So we all climb on the shoulders of everyone, and we help try and give everybody a foot up. That's what it's about. So thank you. And Casper,
you're welcome.
Too.
I have to admit, when young people come up to me and say, thank you, it really means a lot to me. It really does.
I'm glad it does. And as you get older, you tend to appreciate that much more because you know you're having an impact. So again, on behalf of everyone, Judge, thank you for all you've done in this cause.
And your honor, did you want to sing like a canary?
Don't you feed them hemp seeds to get them singing?
You do.
Absolutely. My voice could use all the help it could get. I'd like to put in just a quick plug for Leap, LEAP.cc. We have supporters and we have speakers who are former law enforcement, fighting prohibition of all kinds, governing personal, private behavior. And of course, normal, NORML.org. who in many ways were the beginning of the modern legal fight to legalize.
And how about My Canary?
My Canary, an app for your iPhone, where for things like driving, operating a table saw, you can look at your performance, such as your reaction time, instead of looking at meaningless blood chemistry. MyCanary.com, My Canary app, sorry, MyCanaryApp.com has an outline of the science behind what we've done, and it's on the iTunes store as My Canary. And I have to tell you, the government seems incredibly uninterested, while they seem very interested in things to make it easy for law enforcement, like saliva testing, breath testing, something where law enforcement at the side of the road can say, I see your magic number here is 9, so you must be impaired, when the reality is the science says exactly the opposite. The science is really clear that the number just doesn't correlate with impairment. A 5 for one
Amen.
Person could be a 50 for another.
Amen.
Barry Gainsbourg, what a treat.
Okay. And I want to remind people that we are no longer just a one-hour show, but we are here 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, trying to make a lot of noise about the need to end prohibition. Please make it a point to share us with your friends. Go to our website, download lots of our free MP3s, and share them with your friends. And remember, the next time you hear me, you'll know that it's time for hemp.
Look at all that money, yeah, the money that they spend. Take another look and spend some time for hemp. Don't cut trees for paper, cause it hurts the environment. Stop deforestation, yes.
Education and information, see what all the buzz is all about. It's time for hemp. It's time for hemp.